Welcome back, guys. I hope you have rated me before watching this lecture. Okay, as I requested you in the previous lecture about your feedback matters. So hopefully you have done that. Right. So now we begin with one tool learning, that is Android UI Automator. Now my purpose is to click on this link or scroll down. So whatever it is, first of all, if I want to click on something here, I need to know object of it, right? If you are familiar with Selenium, we have a tools called Firebug in Firefox and Inspector tools in Chrome and Internet Explorer to identify the objects of this, all the UI options. Okay, so if I want to click here, let's say on preference, I need to know the object of this preference. So how do I get object of this preference? So in web, we have a specific tools to do that. But in mobile, how can we get that? So that's an interesting question. So for that, Android guys have came up with tool called UI Automator tool. From that, you can actually get the objects of all these. Now in this lecture, let's try to get the objects of these options with the help of that tool. So where exactly that tool lies? Let me show you. Go to your SDK path / app data. Okay, SDK. Right. So in SDK, go to tools folder and bin, and you will see it here. UI Automator Viewer. Okay, just hit this link. First of all, one window prompt will open like this. Thereafter, within 5 to 10 seconds, you should see the UI Automator Viewer invocation. Here you go. So this is the tool which helps us to identify the objects in our mobile app. So how to do that? Now, I want to get the objects of all these. For that, first of all, you need to hit this link, which takes the screenshot of this app. Okay, make sure that your mobile is open before you invoke this UI Automator Viewer. Okay, so if you invoke this first and then next, you might not see the properties properly. So as per my experience, you need to open emulator first and thereafter UI Automator Viewer. Now, if you want to objects of this page, if you hit this link, it takes the screenshot of entire your device and it gives the objects of it. Let me do that. You see that, obtaining device screenshot, and here you go. So these screenshot, whatever you are seeing here, is replicated in this UI Automator Viewer. And observe it, if I hit any object here, so all the objects, properties, attributes related to that specific OS button are displayed here, like index, text, ID, class name, package. And at the same time, you can see how that XML hierarchy is displayed. You can see that view as well, like text view. If you hit on NFC, you see that it changes. If I hit on hardware, it moves up and it displays all the details related to that hardware. So basically, if you want to click on any object in mobile app, or if you want to perform any operation on specific UI icon, you need details of that UI icon. Okay, with that details only you can click on it. Now for example, if I want to click on app, so I need the details of that app so that I will pass those details in my script, which you will be learning in the next lectures. Okay, by passing the details in that app, and I will say to click on it. Okay, to get the details, we are using this UI Automator Viewer. So with this tool, if you spy on any object here, you will actually get all the details about that object here. Like what is the text, what is the ID given by developer for this hardware, what is the class given by the developer for this hardware. So we need all these details for our automation. Okay, so without these details, we cannot automate. That's pretty sure, right? We need those attributes so that we will pass that in our script and try to click on these links. So to get these details, we are using UI Automator Viewer. So in our every test, to identify every step of automation, we will be keep on depending on this UI Automator viewer to get the object details. Okay, so this was the tool which we use. In general, when we are working with Firefox for web automation, we have a tools like Firebug, Firepath, and developer tools, even in Chrome. In Chrome, to identify the objects for automation, we have right-click, you have inspector tools. If you work with a tool called QTP, and they even have one window to identify all these objects. Okay, they say it is object identification window. At the same time, if someone asks, how can you do that in Appium with Android, you can say that with the help of UI Automator Viewer. Okay, so this you need that before you start the steps. Okay, and thereafter, so this is the one, and let's go back to our code. And I told you that for every test case, these are the common. For at least next 6 to 10 lectures, probably, I'm not sure, based upon, you know, our wavelength, our understanding, that might take up to 10 lectures. So up to 10 lectures at least, I'll be using this API demos app to explain all the concepts of Appium. Okay, so for all those steps, for all those test cases, opening an app and emulator, connecting, these are common steps, right? So what I'll do, I'll place it in base class and I'll create separate test for all my Appium test cases. And I will, you know, call this function there. Okay, so that I don't want to write for every test case. Rather than duplicating, I'll call this function in every my test with a single step, so that, you know, it's easy for us to avoid this writing all the time. So let's do that in this session before, you know, we begin with automation. Let's actually wrap it up in separate function and use it, right? So let's write that in function rather than public static void main. Static capabilities. Okay, so move your mouse here, set retentive to void and add throws declaration. Basically, I'm wrapping all these steps into a function, and in my every test from the next class, when I start doing, for example, in my next class, I'll start on automating one end-to-end scenario of clicking on this link and some validations. So, however, I need to call this all that these steps before I do that. So rather than I'm writing every time, I'll wrap it up in one function, and from in the next test, I will just call this capabilities method. That's it. So I can avoid the duplication of work and time as well. So in the capabilities method, it actually sets file name capabilities, and then I need to return this object. I will say return driver. That's it. And move your mouse, because you need to change the method return type to Android, because when you are writing driver, you need to set return type to this, because this return type data type is this one, right? So same, you need to set it here. Okay, we have one base class. In that base class, we have one capabilities method, right? Which actually does everything. Now, let's start with our one more test class here, which we do actual automation. Here, we'll start with the basics of, you know, identifying an objects with the help of UI Automator. Basics, yeah. So if I want to create one more test, rather than again copying all those stuff, I can simply, first of all, inherit the properties from this base class. I can do that with the help of extends keyword. Okay, so with the help of extends keyword, I can actually use the methods defined in the base class into my basics class. So more about this, you can learn in my core Java tutorial, which you will find at the end of this course. At the end of this course, you have separate dedicated section explaining core Java concepts. Okay, but for now, please don't go there. Let's continue the rhythm. Only in this single lecture, you will see this kind of related Java, because I am reusing the stuff. But from next lecture, you will not come across any core Java stuff. Okay, just don't waste your time again to switching Java. Let's keep momentum going. So if you have not heard about inheritance in your life till now, I'm just going to explain what it is. So with the help of extends keyword, whatever the methods defined in this class, you can reuse in this class if you use this keyword. That's it. And that we say as inheritance, inheriting the properties and methods of parent class to child class. Perfect. Now, so now you can just call capabilities method. Okay, so move your mouse and say change to capabilities, the method name, and add throws declaration. Yeah. So what does, here in our capabilities method, we are returning this driver object, because as I said in my previous lecture, this driver object is responsible for all your automation. Okay, so when you have defined all these steps and you have defined driver method, make sure you send this driver object to your basics class. Okay, so if you don't send this, there's no point of writing that in separate function. We need driver object here to continue our execution from this a specific point. Okay, this step will reach us to till this point. Okay, from here after you need a driver object. So that driver object we already having defined here, right? So we are just returning it. So this method will actually return the capabilities, nothing but driver. So I will assign it to driver. Yeah. So in Java, you cannot leave any variable blank without defining. So for the first time you are defining driver object into this class, right? You need to tell this class what is the data type of this driver. Go back to your capabilities method carefully and see what is the data type. This is the data type, right? Copy it, come back and give it here. That's it. So you're all set. Okay, now run this test. It will again invoke all the steps which are present in this capabilities. Okay, it basically executes this capabilities method. So what we have in capabilities, we have till the method invocation, that app invocation we have, right? And that executes in this basics as well. Now you see that I have avoided all those code in my next class by just calling that specific method. So hereafter I can start directly with driver dot and the Appium related code to automate my stuff. I need not worry about that all desired capabilities, all server, APKs and everything. I will carefully define for single time all these, and I will keep on inheriting and using in my every test case. Okay, till I use the specific emulator and specific APK, I'll just call this step in my every test case. Okay, so now if you run this test, let's see what happens. Okay, make sure your server is on. Okay, so run as Java application, click on OK. You see that it's running. Let me go back. If you see that API demos got invoked with success 200 result, and I don't have any step here just because I called this method. That's it. So we are all set. We know how to get Android UI Automator objects also. In our next lecture, I'll take one end-to-end test case, a scenario, like how to click on preferences, how to click on that link, and how to go to at the end page. Okay, there is some set of scenarios. For every lecture, we will pick one test case, end-to-end scenarios, and we will automate it. Like that, we will learn, you know, all Appium related concepts with this API. And one more thing, so once these lectures are done, from next lecture, count on till 10 to 12 lectures. So once those are completed, you are good to start, you know, updating your resume, because, you know, you need not wait till you complete the course. You can start when you are parallelly running with course, because you know all the basics, right? By the completion of 50% of course, you'll be knowing how does Appium work, how does it invoke, and what are the methods you use. Okay. At the same time, you can actually update your resume with the Appium skills, which you are keep on learning. Okay, just don't wait till you finish the course completely. So if you want any inputs in resume as well, please drop me an email. I have good resumes on Appium template, like how to put all those in the project. I can give you so that, you know, you can use that in your resume. So all the resume inputs which I'm giving will be related to this course. So it's easy to you for, you know, compare and use that skill in your resume, so that if someone asks a question on that, you can clearly answer, right? So if you want anything that, you can email to this Gmail address. Okay, that's pretty much, and we'll meet in the next lecture with a sample test case, and we'll take from there. Okay, thank you.